Om Namah Shivaya. Welcome back to Sunday Chanting and Meditation. Today we are going to sing Om Namah Shivaya very slowly today. And we have Shiva again. Thank you to Sandy Leader. This beautiful representation of Nataraj, the dancing Shiva. Shiva is the destroyer. Shiva is the all-knowing one, the supreme being, supreme reality. And as we chant to ourselves this aspect of ourself that lives in each and every one of us. So we're honoring ourself and the integrity that lies within. And today we have Nick with us playing the Shruti and chanting. And what we've decided to do is chant three Oms, followed by seven Om Namah Shivayas, very, very slowly. And you will follow along as we carry on because we're going slow enough that I think you can just catch right on board. And then we'll go back to three Oms. So it'll be three Oms, seven Om Namah Shivayas, three Oms, seven Om Namah Shivayas. We'll do that three times, and then we'll have a bit of time to chant at the, or to meditate at the end, and we'll just drop right into stillness. So I thank you for joining us today, the last Sunday in May. So let's get grounded, feel your feet on the earth, and let's just take one deep breath together. And let's start with one Om together, and then we'll go into the three Oms, followed by the seven Om Namah Shivayas. Inhale. So relax your shoulders and your jaw. Let your skin relax, your skull relax, and align your spine so you are present for the chant and the meditation. Okay. Three Oms. Join in.
Shiva. Namah.
eyes, then we'll drop into meditation very slowly. Inhaling. And place your hands on your heart if you'd like to feel that vibration right through your heart. Inhaling. Keep hearing your inner self going, oh. Oh. continue to hear the vibration. It'll continue to play. Nick will keep playing. Feel that vibration from the crown chakra running all the way through your root chakra down into the core of the earth. Feel the channel of light up and down. That Om, the infinite Om, no beginning, no end, running right through every chakra, through the Shishumna channel, and out into the universe. Honoring all beings in the universe. Supreme truth. Sat Chit Ananda, truth and bliss absolute. Let us chant 9 Om's and Om Shanti together. Take a deep breath. Peace, peace, peace. Thank you, Nick. Thank you, everyone. Namaste. Om Namah Shivaya. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Dr. Araya. Welcome to the Center for Spiritual Awakening. I'm your greeter today. Come on in.
Oh, my heavens, it's so good to be with you all again. Oh, happy day. My name is Reverend David Hayward, and this is CSA Sunday. We are grateful you made your way to our spiritual center. If you're on a spiritual path and are seeking a deeper connection with your divine inner presence, you are definitely in the right place. Welcome, and we hope you feel right at home. Ah, my delicious divinities. So wonderful to see you all again. Welcome, welcome, welcome. We're truly honored by your presence with us today. I'm a staff minister here at the Center for Spiritual Awakening in wonderful downtown PG, nestled as we are in the gorgeous Monterey Peninsula on the central California coast. Well, mindfulness has certainly been at the forefront of thinking these days, hasn't it? It's mentioned a lot. Groucho Marx had a great comment about this. He said, "Hey, why go off in a huff? With a little more effort, you can go off in a minute and a half." How true. This week, I happened upon a YouTube video of a BBC Two program from August 1965. It was on great acting. The 60s, you know, were a rich time in British theatre, I think. The National Theatre was built, the Royal Shakespeare Company was doing modern plays at the Aldwych in the West End of London, the Royal Court Theatre was doing a lot of provocative new stuff, and a lot of newcomers were working with very well-established older actors. Probably Judi Dench, Vanessa Redgrave, Maggie Smith arose in that, out of that area. Came across Ralph Richardson, and he was talking about the process of acting and saying, when one is performing, we're really using at least two or three levels of consciousness. It's true, as soon as an actor steps on stage, they very swiftly feel the temper of the audience. You know, what's up in the house? Do we push it, pull it back? Where are we with each other? And then, of course, you're taking care of the blocking, the movements, the mechanical sides of things, the ballet, if you like, of where to be on stage at any time. And then you're likely refining the part, the performance as you go, consciously trying to fine-tune that performance. And another part, perhaps, is actually living the character you're portraying, living in a part of the mind where everything is happening. Because if the actor doesn't believe it, the audience won't. And he concluded, in a sense, it's a controlled dream. I love all that because it seemed a good metaphor for life. Whatever we are doing in life, are we conscious or are we absorbed in the role? And how's that affecting everyone around us? But the quote that I loved the best was from an actor back in the day named Joseph Jefferson. And he said, "As for me, I perform best when my heart is warm and my head is cool." I thought that was, that's profound. I love that. What a wonderful thought for the day. So, at the Center for Spiritual Awakening, we love having Dr. Bill Little as our spiritual director. We do, we do, we do. Dr. Bill has been a metaphysical teacher on the Monterey Peninsula now for over 40 years. He holds a PhD in physics as well. So it's a rare and wonderful combination. His topic today is the art of release. As well as this inspiring Sunday program, CSA offers a lot of insightful courses and events that you're sure to enjoy. Dennis Murphy, our music director, has invited the talented Gary Meek this week on saxophone and keyboards. Thank you, Gary, so much. And a little more good news, the Mind Shop, our beloved and special metaphysical gift shop and bookstore, is filled with treasures. I'm happy to say we'll open for online shopping beginning this week. So you can simply and easily schedule an online Google Meet appointment by visiting our website, and you'll meet your very own personal shopper online, and that will be the wonderful Marie O'Reilly or myself. And we shall be delighted to help you thereupon. Select your perfect items and charge your credit card and offer curbside and contact-free delivery. So that's all the good news for now. Once again, thank you for being with us. Please sit back and enjoy the program, and I will see you later. Ciao for now.
This is Nick, missing you all, hoping everyone is taking care of themselves and staying healthy and staying positive and just staying in the moment. I've been really busy with gardening. I've been in there for 2 to 3 weeks, and that's what's keeping me happy and in the moment. So miss you all, and I'll see you really soon. Love you all.
Okay. Hi, folks. This is Ted. I am really glad to be a member of this church and have this church community and the people in it. And I've been in metaphysics for probably 40, 50 years, and have been at different churches in Southern California and around, and I think this is probably the best. And boy, I'm just blessed. I think we're blessed to have this here. So, yeah.
Welcome, everyone. We want to thank each and every one of you for watching. Today, I want to talk to you for just a moment about an issue that's recently come to my attention. There's a category of, I'll call them helpers, right here at CSA, that are rarely talked about, that don't get the attention that they deserve, and are even sometimes taken for granted, including by me. These helpers have performed tirelessly for decades without complaint, but are now experiencing some emotional difficulties as a result of the coronavirus pandemic. Of course, I am referring to our tightly woven community of collection baskets. Yes, collection baskets have feelings too. In an earlier interview, our baskets reported feeling forgotten, alone, abandoned, that their lives had no more purpose, that they felt empty. I did my best to help them understand that none of this was their fault, and that we love them, and that soon we would be back at CSA with them every Sunday, filling them with cash and checks again, just like we used to. I told the baskets that until we could be back with them in person, we would think of them every time we used the donate button. And I promised them that we would use the donate button often. Please help me keep that promise. Join me again next week for another episode of Basket Case. And now, please enjoy more of today's wonderful program.
Hi there. Dennis Murphy, our music director, has invited back, by popular demand, the incredible Gary Meek. Gary is a jazz and fusion saxophone and keyboard artist and has performed on more than 150 albums. We at CSA are lucky and grateful to have him. Enjoy.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the CSA Sunday service. Last week, we looked at this pandemic that we're in and asked the question, why is it here? Is it trying to teach us something? And we came up with some interesting ideas. And that is, well, maybe it's a kind of hot poker motivation for us to leave a lifestyle that is kind of like imprisonment. A lifestyle created by our ego structure, which is a sort of cobbling together of suggestions from other people, culture, and so forth and so on. And basically functions as we get older as a trap, a prison. And perhaps this pandemic is trying to get us to reassess our lives and actually break through and have more freedom, more fulfillment. So with that idea, let's go back. A question that arises at this point is, okay, I'm staying at home, I'm with my family, friends, and so forth. And really, yeah, I'm reminding myself that love is very important. I love my family, I love my friends. And those moments where love takes over, very beautiful. Now love, please understand, is not an emotion. Love can function through our emotional nature, but emotions are things that are actually created out of states of mind. You know, if we assume that there's danger in this world, we're going to have fear. We manufacture those emotions. That's not what love is. Love is a presence that's there when the mind is not there at all. If you go into meditation and you go very deeply into meditation, there's no mind, no thinking. And yet there's love. And this love that is there is extremely profound. It's unconditional because there's no mind to put conditions on it. So love is a very different experience. And if that is a valuable experience to us, and I can't imagine that it wouldn't be, then, okay, is it time to change our lifestyle to incorporate love? And in that case, there's a question that arises, and that question is simply, how do I release the past unwanted habits that I've developed about working, perhaps struggling, trying to make ends meet, this kind of stuff? How do I come out of that prison? How do I have more fulfillment as a conscious being? Good question. So this week we're going to look at the art of releasing, because truly speaking, the more we release, the more love there is. It's that simple. The love's already there. The love's in us. We can't create love. Love, in a sense, creates us. But if we have lots of clouds in front of the sun, it's going to seem like it's dark. And that's what happens with our minds. So how do I release the unwanted habits of the past? We're going to go back to Taoism. We talked about Taoism last week as being a teaching that is down to earth and at the same time really profound. He was a marvelous teacher, Lao Tzu. Here in this slide, he discusses his teaching. It's interesting what words he uses. My teachings are easy to understand and easy to put into practice. Yet your intellect will never grasp them. And if you try to practice them, you'll fail. My teachings are older than the world. How can you grasp their meaning? If you want to know me, look inside your heart. Heart, our feeling center. It's been told to us by everybody, by spiritual teachers for thousands of years, by psychologists, by everybody who is aware of mind and the consequences of mind. Go into the heart. Why? Because the heart is a vast region. It is far greater than the mind. It has far more subtlety than the mind. It has nuances of feeling that are magnificent that the mind can't even describe. It can bring about experiences of fulfillment that we could never plan on, never strategize about. The heart is like that. It's an amazing place. If you look at definitions, and you want only a short definition of Tao, you get things like way, path, rote, doctrine, principle. But that's not enough. We need a definition that is more subtle than those. And I found one that I thought was pretty good. It was in a dictionary of all places. And the definition is this. Tao is the natural order of the universe whose character one's human intuition must discern in order to realize the potential for individual wisdom. This intuitive knowing of life cannot be grasped as a concept. It is known through actual living experience of one's everyday being. One's everyday being. Amazing. When you contemplate this definition and try to understand it perhaps in some terms that are more usable for you, some ideas that maybe make it clearer for you, some very interesting ideas come up. For example, I'm going to just put one forth now, see what we can do with it. What if Tao is what we call awareness? Could it be so? Let's see. Awareness is our essence. And I think I mentioned last week, if you find a child, let's say four or 5 months old, 6 months old, something like that, and you look at that child, you're looking at pure awareness. They don't have a mind yet. They can't think. They just barely have some senses. And they're just simply aware. And they're irresistible. Good picture. Beautiful. That child is just pure awareness. Now, that's certainly true at that age. And I think they're irresistible to us because not only do we need to take care of them, but in some sense, they take care of us. They show us who we are. But it's also true that awareness is, it does escape us only because we're not interested in it. But it's not like it's rare. Let's take a look at this. With each turn of the head, reality appears as awareness, in awareness. Wherever you are, whenever you are, you, awareness, is all there truly is. With every blink of the eye, the illusion of the world disappears and reappears, all of it happening within you, awareness. Yeah. So even as an adult, someone with thoughts, feelings, images, desires, and so forth, none of that could exist without, first of all, being awareness. So the Tao is everything. Well, maybe the Tao is awareness. The Hindus, the ancient Hindus, thousands of years ago, attributed something to this feeling or experience called awareness. They said, awareness is creation. That is the creator. And why? Well, let's say you buy a house and you haven't been up to the attic yet, and you take your flashlight, it's at nighttime, you can't see up there. So you open the attic, go inside, turn on the flashlight. You're illuminating whatever is up there, maybe an old trunk or who knows what. And for the first time, that old trunk is in your reality. It was never there before. You had to shine the light of awareness on it so that awareness, in a very real sense, is the creator, because it brings into the scope of itself something new, something fresh, awareness. Zen thinking. And so, all that can ever truly be known is the here and now, whose totality is always this present moment presence of awareness. It is never not this. And this is what it means to know yourself. Awareness is yourself, and you are all there truly is. You are everything and yet nothing. That's why the definition of the Tao is so elusive. It's everything and yet no thing at all. So it looks like trading awareness for Tao might be a good idea. Now, it's also true that if we use ongoing awareness of some kind of object, it creates a great deal of richness. As we continue to dwell on the objects or people in our lives, more and more reveals itself. We're rewarded with good understanding just simply because we continue to place awareness on something. We learn about it. We develop an understanding of a particular flower or perhaps a relationship in our lives. Great potential for personal empowerment can be found in attending to our awareness of global problems and to our understanding of how they connect with each other and with our personal lives. The process of naming the danger, saying aloud that the threats to life on Earth are real, moves us from the numbness of denial to the aliveness that makes action possible. Sarah Connor. Very well said. A richness develops by shedding awareness and not being afraid to shed awareness on whatever. Now, awareness is also non-judgmental. It doesn't judge good, bad, right, or wrong. The moment you move into judgment about something, all learning stops. The moment you've made a judgment, you've locked yourself into a particular position and you can't move beyond it. And when you can't move, you can't grow. Here's another little comment about judgment that I think is well taken. The fact that you're judging people's maturity levels on the way they present themselves is also pretty immature. Maturing is realizing how many things don't require your comment. Okay. We keep going. Keep contemplating the Tao as awareness. Okay. Not only is it non-judgmental, but awareness cultivates the sense of awesomeness or the miraculous sense. One of the great teachers of many years ago said, a monk asks, is there anything more miraculous than the wonders of nature? The master answers, yes, your awareness of the wonders of nature. It's a mind stopper, isn't it? Angelus Silesius. Yes, the wonders of nature would mean nothing if there wasn't a person to perceive them. And the person who perceives them actually transcends the wonders of nature. It's amazing. So awareness also brings us into a sense of awesomeness, the miraculous. Now, from a practical point of view, what can we do? Well, we're with our families, and sometimes there are children or grandchildren there, you know. Just giving them attention causes them to blossom. The only thing we do not want to do with our children and grandchildren is ignore them, because that sends a message, and that message is not healthy. Just shining your attention on them, and they can be at any stage, it doesn't make any difference. They may be developing very strong ego, it doesn't matter. They need your attention, because your attention is the love they need to be accepted as they are. And if they're accepted as they are, then they can grow into something else. But if they are not accepted as they are, they'll never grow into anything. It's very simple. So, good parenting is the name of the game now. Yeah, lots of families are together. And, you know, because dad is usually not there, or some mother sometimes, now they're here. Oh, all the attention we're getting, the kids are just joyous. Something they've always wanted. They grow physically, they grow mentally, and eventually they'll grow a bit emotionally, especially in the teenage years. But then something very interesting happens. Almost all of them leave. They break from the family group. They might go off to college, go off to a job that's somewhere else, and so forth. Now at that point, it's very difficult for the parents and the grandparents and so forth, because they love their children and grandchildren, and now they're going. I remember years ago when I took my daughter Jennifer up to college up in Sacramento, three-hour trip up Highway 101. And we got there, unloaded all of her stuff into her dorm room and things like that. It was a hot August day. And then it came time to say goodbye. It's very difficult. So difficult that probably the greatest percentage of the time driving back to Monterey, I was filled with tears. And yet, something in me knew that this had to happen. She had to go on her own. And I'm really glad that she did, because she's become a wonderful woman. She is one of the best mothers I've ever seen, and a wonderful human being, extremely talented, because she was set free to be herself. Which means that awareness, love, Tao, eventually is freedom. It sets the object of love, the object of the Tao or the awareness, free to be itself. And that is the greatest love. That's God's love. We are all set here free to be ourselves because we're loved by our Creator. That doesn't mean we're not here to help. My daughter called me many times in the first few years of college. Yes, we had a lot of conversations, but it does mean that we're being set free to be who we are. This is a little cartoon here I thought you'd enjoy. First day of school, yep, kids are hanging onto the tree. Mom's trying to pull them off. First day of college, mom's hanging onto the tree. Yeah. To be set free to explore our world, explore our nature, our relationships, very important. Yeah, sometimes we want to see it upside down and just be weird. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Indeed, if there's too much attachment, even in a parent-child relationship, it's unhealthy. Being attached is what prevents us from seeing. It is what clouds this miraculous awareness. Attachment clouds awareness, which means attachment is a form of resistance to the Tao. Most of us are totally convinced that we can do things. We take a walk, develop a skill, now that we're sheltering at home, maybe it's a hobby that we're considering or engaging in. But we really need to look at this whole concept of, are we the doers? I know that's not a real word, but no, it should be. You know, we need that word. Are we really the ones that do things? Or is it a bit more subtle than that? For example, let's say you're going out and you're exercising and you want to do some jogging and so forth. All right, you go ahead and jog. Yeah, look, I'm jogging. Not quite. Who's beating the heart? Well, it just beats, yeah. And who's digesting the food to give you the energy to have the run? See, when you look at it closely, we run into problems. You know, it's a kind of embarrassing. Things are more subtle. Are we really doing something like mowing the grass outside, or are we doing a part of it? And there's something else doing a lot of other stuff to get it to happen. Using the muscular skeletal system, the nervous system, so forth and so on. In Taoism, there is a wonderful classic story that explores this problem. Now, first of all, if you're a vegetarian, my apologies. This story is called The Dexterous Butcher. First of all, we're going to watch a little video of it, and then we'll talk about it a little bit. It's a marvelous story.
Contains a story about a cook named Ting, who engages in his work while in a state of flow. This grasped the attention of Lord Wen Hui, who was amazed about how elegantly the cook cut up oxen. When he commented him on his skill, Cook Ting laid down his knife and replied, "What I care about is the way, which goes beyond skill. When I first began cutting up oxen, all I could see was the ox itself. After 3 years, I no longer saw the whole ox. And now I go at it by spirit and don't look with my eyes. Perception and understanding have come to stop, and spirit moves where it wants. I go along with the natural makeup, strike in the big hollows, guide the knife through the big openings, and following things as they are. So I never touch the smallest ligament or tendon, much less a main joint." End quote. An essential part of this story is the condition of the knife that the cook uses. He stated that good cooks change their knives every year because they cut, and mediocre cooks change their knives every month because they hack. Cook Ting, however, was using the same knife for 19 years.
Interesting, isn't it? He says, "I go along with the natural makeup. When I come to the tricky parts, I slow down." The Taoists thought that story was so important that that picture that you see there was engraved in a cave in the Han Dynasty. It's a tomb. They put it into stone because they wanted it to last for centuries and millennia. It's an important story. Our nature is to be active, there's no doubt about that. But the presumptuousness of "I am doing the action" causes us to fail quite a bit. Am I part of the action? Yes. Does it require my agreement and my assent? Yes. But there's something else that is actually involved with the doing of the action. Now, I want to talk about this for just a little bit, because many years ago, I was in an ashram up in Oakland, and in ashrams, you're always asked to do something called seva, S-E-V-A, which means selfless service. It means doing service without any thought of return. You're not getting anything from it, you're just doing it to do it. And, of course, I did it. I was I think in the kitchen, I don't know what, I think it was cleaning the stove, the oven, that kind of stuff. And, you know, no one's going to come over and give me stars for it or pay me anything or anything like that. I just did it. And that's fine. I perfectly agreed to doing it. You know, I was very enthusiastic about the teacher and the teaching and the ashram and being there. I was so happy. I was grateful. So I'm just doing it. After, I don't know, maybe an hour or so, something very unusual happened. There we were, you know, of course it's an oven or a stove, so there's a lot of grease and stuff all over the place. And I looked down and I watched this person doing it. And something else was actually doing the doing. It wasn't me doing it. I had no sense of performing the action. I was just watching the action being performed, and it was being performed correctly. You know, I didn't have to change anything. It was just happening. The doing was coming from another place. The great beings have said seva is the practice which will get you the experience of your inner self more quickly than anything. Within minutes or an hour or whatever it may be, all of a sudden you have a sense that you're not the one doing an action. You're the one witnessing the doing of the action, which of course is awareness. Now we could expand the dexterous butcher story out to include everything in our lives. We're always negotiating a world situation. You know, events happen every day. They're different. Everything comes up. We don't expect them sometimes and so forth. There's, to go back to one of the great Taoist masters, Pu, here's a picture of something from the 100-acre wood. Yeah, over on the right-hand side, you see what's called my house. That's Christopher Robin's house. And on the left-hand side, opposite it, is Pooh Bear's house. And there's lots of little streams and pathways you could take to go from one to another. And of course, you have to make some decisions. This is a metaphor for our daily life. You know, well, am I going to go down to this store now and get off, put my mask on and get food? Or am I going to go to this one over here because they have some things that the others don't? And, you know, we have to make these choices about what happens in our life. We negotiate the pandemic as well as we can. Pooh, of course, is not like that. Pooh is a real Taoist. Therefore, he isn't terribly interested in what paths to take. He just simply goes out and wanders. And eventually he ends up wherever he's supposed to end up, and that's fine with him. That's the way Taoists are. You know, they don't sit down and strategize about things. But usually for the regular person, yes, we do have to make some decisions about that. The question is, do we make those decisions from the past, which would be our ego nature, or do we make decisions out of the moment, listening to that subtle felt presence of awareness? It may be that under certain weather conditions, you want to take one path instead of another. But do we stop and listen to the felt presence of our own awareness? That presence can guide us, and it will, but we have to learn to listen to the subtlety of it instead of just knee-jerk reactions from the ego. Many teachers have talked about this. Here's Rumi. Observe the wonders as they occur around you. Don't claim them. Feel the artistry moving through and be silent. Don't grieve. Anything you lose comes round in another form. One of the great modern Taoists, Alan Watts. The whole process of nature is an integrated process of immense complexity, and it is really impossible to tell whether something that happens in it is good or bad, because you never know what will be the consequences of the misfortune, or you never know what will be the consequences of good fortune. Even world problems can be looked at in this way. Yes, of course, we do have an interest in the world problems. I mean, we've got media bombarding us all the time, and we contemplate world problems, overpopulation, ecological problems, things of this nature, political problems. Recently, the Dalai Lama was a great example of using awareness instead of ego, he said. In an age when news travels so fast around the world, our sense of community and our concern for those far away from us have grown enormously. In the early 20th century, feelings of nationalism were very strong, while awareness of our entire humanity was quite weak. In those days, people were less aware of what was happening in other regions or other continents. But now, with global media transmitting news at such speed, we have a deeper awareness of the interconnectedness of people everywhere. Together with this, people's concern for humanity as a whole and their recognition of the basic value of basic human rights seem to be deepening as well. To me, this trend is a source of great optimism about the future. So he looks at the internet, he looks at media, he looks at satellites, and he says, this could be a tremendous advantage for us. Why? Because our concern for the well-being of each other will transmit itself even faster than that media works. He knows that the thinking of every human being is important. He knows that because we are now enlightened about events that we never before could imagine, we can do something about them with our thoughts. Yes. And if you are moved to do that, using treatment, using meditation, whatever it may be, it's powerful. It's going to have an effect. The aspect of awareness that came up a little while ago that frees everything, awareness being divine love, and divine love frees you to be yourself, is also how we become free of our ego. And it's also the way we can free others. Yeah, our ego needs freedom, but it requires awareness. We have to become aware of the prison that we're in. If we shine the light of our love on our own ego, then our ego, which is, I was going to say a person, but it's actually many people, will feel fulfilled because it's being unconditionally loved. If we love ourselves, in other words, if we shine the light of our awareness on our own personality structure and love it the way it is, then the faults that we have will change, they'll grow, they turn into something else. Just like shining the light of your conscious awareness on a particular plant in your garden. By appreciating that plant, it will get the energy of your awareness and grow into something very beautiful. Deepak Chopra puts it this way: ultimately, spiritual awareness unfolds when you're flexible, when you're spontaneous, when you're detached, when you're easy on yourself and easy on others. Now this helps in negotiating the world situation because we're all in a world of relationships. Easy on others. Lao Tzu talked about this also. Knowing others is intelligence. Knowing yourself is true wisdom. Mastering others is strength. Mastering yourself is true power. If you realize that you have enough, you're truly rich. If you stay in the center and embrace death with your whole heart, you will endure forever. That center is awareness, the source of the Tao. Amazing. Very beautiful. Let's go back to relationships for just a few minutes. There are some guidelines that come out of Taoism and all teachings too. For example, in a relationship with another human being, one of the great ways to start is to accept the fact that that other human being is actually a form of you. Now this sounds silly if you haven't heard it before, you know, you say, oh, that's some sort of strange metaphysics. It's far more than that, try it out. If you realize the person you're talking to is actually a form of you, then you will treat them with respect because you respect yourself. You respect your own life. and you listen to them. Someone has said recently, the biggest communication problem is that we do not listen to understand, we listen to reply. How true that is. That's easy to show. Just watch. In a few minutes, you'll see it. But what if we listen to understand them? What if they got the feeling that we were really interested in understanding them? That's a form of love. Yeah, I accept you the way you are. Let me understand who you are. It's a form of love. That in itself sets them free. Because love always sets us free to be who we are. Now let's also understand that we ourselves have the right to be who we are. In other words, we're not here just to reflect the thoughts and feelings of either parental injunctions or culture or society or what's the latest thing, trend, and so forth. That's not what we're here for. We're here to be ourselves. We're here to be very unique. The unique self. Mark Goffney had a beautiful book on that. The unique self. That's who we are. You know, why would God create 7 billion different souls on this one planet and make them all the same? That doesn't make any sense. We're all unique. So we're here to be ourselves. Lao Tzu said, the way to do is to be. Be who we are. So let your ego be who it wants to be. And just be aware of it, that's all. And if you, as you do that, the ego will gradually feel loved the way it is and feel free to expand into something greater. So, you know, people on the spiritual path very often think, I've got to kill my ego. I've got to, you know, somehow get rid of it and so forth. All that does is create a lot of fear. You know, the ego doesn't want to be killed. It's part of your being. So the way to do is to be. Okay, first go into your being and love your ego the way it is. And if your ego just wants a day off and doesn't want to struggle anymore, give it a day off. And if it wants to say something in a relationship situation that it has never said before, let it say it. In other words, take care of your own ego. Yeah. And it probably wants to have some fun too, a lot more than most people give it. And then there's this thing about having to agree with people. You know, the truth of the matter is, agreement is not a very healthy energy. Modern corporations know this. When they put together their corporate designs and so forth, they want committees made up of many people from a particular branch of their business who don't necessarily agree. Because only when you disagree can newness happen. Can you understand each other and arrive at something even greater than either of you had? You know, roses and daffodils are nowhere near alike, but they're very beautiful together. You know, just very simple. One of the greatest examples of this in human history was Mahatma Gandhi. And here's what he said. Honest disagreement is often a good sign of progress. And he really would know. He freed an entire nation with that. Now, self-awareness is the next step. I'm talking about the awareness of a spiritual self, a deep self. Being aware of one's own presence is by far the highest practice. And this is the way we change. This is the way we release the past. A modern teacher, whose name is Muji, said, step into the fire of self-discovery. The fire will not burn you. It will only burn what you are not. And that what we are not is usually called our ego nature. It will just naturally change. It will see the foolishness of, you know, judgment and so forth and so on, and let go of it naturally. It may not do it overnight, but love it the way it is. If it's making an attempt, that's it. Love it, making an attempt. Interesting comment here. The identification with the me, with this psychological sense of being, is merely an appearance within the consciousness, just an image. In other words, the roles that we're playing are like images on a screen, maybe a movie screen. Yeah. You know, if you look at that screen, yeah, of course, most of us will think that's a real person and they're really feeling what they seem to be feeling and so forth. But truly speaking, it's just light being shed on a screen, that's all. In other words, we're in a story. And that story, you know, it has some things to learn, it helps us grow. But that story does include some difficult growth, such as pandemics. And it could include some very difficult people. I'm sure you've all met some. But remember, they're just projections onto the screen of the mind. Yeah. And that's the way awareness does see things. It sees things as being basically all equal, all just projections. Let's take a particular practice to use this week. It's a practice of releasing. And it comes from the 20th century Siddha, a great Siddha, Swami Muktananda. This would be the practice of releasing that he prescribed. And we're going to put it on several slides so that if you want to, you can take pictures with your cell phone or whatever you'd like to do, so you can actually develop a practice to use on a daily basis. He gave us these quotes to use, and here they are. The first two are this: I am not the son / daughter of parents, and name the parents. I am not this body. I am not these senses. I am not the mind that identifies with this body and these senses. I am the witness of this mind now. I am the witness of this mind now. I am the witness of this mind now. See, that puts you in the state of realizing that the ego is just a figment of the imagination. It is a projection onto a screen. I am the witness of this mind now. It thinks this mind is saying, oh, look, I have this body. Won't you call it I? No, that's not me. I am the witness of this mind now. I'll go back so you can see him again and see right from the beginning. I am not the son or daughter of, and then you name, you know, Mary and Jim or whoever it is. I am not this body. I am not these senses. I am not the mind that identifies with this body and these senses. I am the witness of this mind now, three times. Do it in the morning when you first wake up, and of course, repeat it during the day as often as you want to. And I thought a nice final slide that would be a good one to quote in our pandemic era is this one. I am so awesome, even my immune system can't get enough of me. Thank you for joining me. Namaskar.
Let's explore releasing ourselves from the prison of our own limited egoic self-identity. Let's imagine that we're on the floor of an old-time prison, dirt floor, old metal, and we've sat there for a long time, not thinking that we could release ourselves. Step out, escape from our own identity. And so today, we imagine that we stand up And we don't need to know how to do it. There is a way. And we just start moving like poo. And the way starts to reveal itself as we reach this old-fashioned door that we haven't touched in ages. We realize that it's open. And so we step out, just trusting the way will lead us to the light, to freedom. And so move forward. But more than move forward under your own auspices, imagine that you're being led forward. The way is unfolding. Something's happening. There's energy opening up. There's this sense of follow the freedom, follow the light that guides you homeward. And just move forward and let the way take you. And trust that light, that unfoldment. Trust the way. And we ask that this healing be integrated. And so it is.
I'm Michael Clark. I'm on the board of stewards here at CSA. We're entering week 11. I'd like to first and foremost thank everybody for your generous support. And secondly, and equally important, I encourage you all to stay engaged, enjoy our Sunday services, enjoy our classes, enjoy our circle group. Now is the time for community, and we're stronger when we stand together. Thank you.
Well, hello again. Thanks again for being with us today. Thanks to Dr. Bill, thanks to Gary Meek, Dr. Rick Moss. But you know, always and most of all, thank you to you for your amazing presence in being part of this community. Let's just remember before we go that there is only one presence. And this presence is being us right now. So that means then all the power there is, all the love there is, all the intelligence is focused in this moment. We are not then victims. We are the children of that living presence, of a divine mind. So any problems that we have during the day, during the week, during the month, bring them and offer them up to that divine intelligence. And just know that our troubles will fall away because we're enwrapped by a loving divinity that cares for us. We just let it go. We give it to that divine mind. We give it to the law. And then we let it rest. And we go out and have a little fun. Okay. Quick reminder, once again, to visit the Mind Shop on our website, csa-pg.org. You can schedule your online appointment this week with Marie or myself. And today, the wonderful Stephen Bergman is going to send us off with a special familiar message. So once again, I'm Reverend David Hayward. This is CSA Sunday, and we'll see you next week.
Hi, it's Stephen Bergman, wishing us all well.